Well, hello there, my name is Nick Sanzone. I'm the Environmental Programs Coordinator for the City of Satellite Beach. Tonight is our first workshop in 2018 as a sustainability workshop series as part of the Sustainability Action Plan. We have green achievement targets as part of the plan. If you have heard of the plan before, bear with me for a minute while I go over it real quickly, just to get everybody up to speed. Basically, the Sustainability Action Plan was put forward by the city after a resiliency study was put in place. The city did some work with FIT, and they came up with over 120 different green achievement targets that they wanted to achieve. They narrowed that down to about 88 targets they want to do the next 20 years, separated in five-year goals. One of those we're covering tonight, actually two of them tonight. One of them is the Sustainability Action Plan's workshop series, which is, this is number one. And number two is going to be our soft infrastructure enhancement, also known as the DeSoto Swale Enhancement Project, Stormwater Enhancement Project. So we're going to talk about stormwater, impacts of stormwater, and how to mitigate against that. Tonight's workshop is called Isn't It Swale? Well, play on words there. Hope you all enjoyed that. There'll be plenty more of those jokes as we go along. So this is community outreach. This is for you guys and those of the folks at home that couldn't make it. You can watch this at home on YouTube and on our Facebook page, as well as the city website. Main idea, outreach about sustainability, discussing today bioswales and the DeSoto Parkway Drainage Basin Stormwater Enhancement Project and how it's going to benefit the community. I know it's a mouthful, but it's a good project that we got funded with the NEP, the National Estuary Program, as part of a series of soft infrastructure upgrades to the city. So we'll go over some basic aspects of the plan, and then we'll go into the detail of bioswales, how to build a bioswale, what they consist of, why they're important, and how they work. So the plan, as I briefly discussed a little bit, Sustainability Action Plan, is something that you're going to see in the near future being implemented in many ways. One of them is this. Other ways is we put solar, or we're going to put solar on City Hall. That was approved. That's in the contract. Another way is the city just went ahead and purchased its first electric vehicle, Chevy Bolt. So now we have an electric vehicle charging station, not only at Pelican Park, but also here at City Hall. And there's going to be a number of other different infrastructure and projects and programs that we put forward as part of the Sustainability Action Plan. Those green achievement targets that I outlined, there's 20 of them that we're doing, and so far we're checking them off the list here in 2018. This workshop is one of them, and the project is another. So this all started on May 3rd, and it's going to be, like I said, ongoing. So if you haven't been involved in it so far, you can join other projects and programs like the Climate Ambassadors. You can start either being aware of those different things that are going on, stay involved with Facebook pages and things like that, or attend our workshops. So who are the workshops for? They're for everyone. There's going to be one every month, and that should be an insert inside of your handout as well. What are they going to be? Workshops. When are they going to happen? Well, the third Thursday of every month, hopefully. And as part of this workshop today, being the first of the workshop series, I want to talk to you folks, because you were brave enough to actually come out and join us tonight. Where would you like to see these future workshops take place? Should they be here at City Hall? Should we go out into the community? Would it be a good idea to go to restaurants and different venues where the community might be more receptive to coming out to these types of events? That's something that I like to talk at the end. So think about that. We'll do questions at the end, and you guys can come up with some better ideas than I can. So where we'll talk about that. Why community involvement? How with your support? So the whole idea behind the Sustainability Action Plan and my position in general as the Environmental Programs Coordinator is to get the community involved with a lot of the projects we're doing. So my phone number, my contact information is right there on the back. So business cards available for anybody that wants one. Please reach out to me with any project ideas or questions or comments on the things that the city's doing, especially in regards to the environment. Specifically with this project, which you're going to start seeing happen on DeSoto. So which areas in DeSoto are we talking about? Talking more specifically about the medians. So those medians on DeSoto are rather wide, and those of you that have lived here for a while have noticed that, you know, in times of great storms like the hurricanes, they tend to gather a little water. Well, we want to try to mitigate against that and against the regular amount of water that it would handle by installing the swales. We're gonna wanna do that with your help. So the whole idea behind this is a lot of volunteer outreach. So we're involving the scouts, we're involving homeschool groups, we're involving regular residents and students from the local high school, and hopefully also search sites for each group as well. So we're still gathering some support, but we can always use more. If you need to plan a work day with us, we can talk about that in the future as well. Join some of those other educational groups as they happen. There'll be some opportunities for younger kids that want to do summer camps through the rec center to come out and join us, as well as learn about other educational opportunities around the city, like Sampson's Island, beach cleanups, and things of that nature. So a quick little task outline as part of this DeSoto Stormwater Enhancement Project with the swales, the bioswales, the main focus. So we want to let people know what's going on before the project happens. So I went out there already and I started lighting DeSoto's meetings a little bit. You might notice some white paint out there. That's so that we know where to put the swales. So three educational signs, they're gonna go out, not just in front of the where the swales are gonna go, but also along two of the ponds. If you travel down towards the library, you'll see there's two stormwater ponds. The stormwater infrastructure actually leads out into those ponds as well. So we wanna vegetate them as well, because vegetation absorbs nutrients from the stormwater as it percolates through the soil profile. And estimating roughly 18,000 square feet of enhanced vegetated area, including the swales and the shorelines of the ponds. Approximately 10,000 educational door hangers that include the surveys that you have today, the bioswale information, and the workshop insert. So not just native plants that you know, but maybe some native plants that you don't know. So we're talking about spartina grasses. There are three different varieties of spartina grass we're going to look at primarily and expand from there. These spartina grasses are the ones that you see typically growing about waist high, and we have a few of them out here in our ponds in front of City Hall. Mangroves are also going to go along the shoreline of the ponds, but not in the swales. So there's a specific location for certain plants. UF always says right plant, right place is kind of the theme for a lot of those things. We're going to try to use roughly 2,500 feet of coquina rock to replace the grasses along the ditch. I'm working up the budget of that right now. We might use smaller rocks. May have to use some coquina, some not, depending on, you know, the budget of cost of some of these materials. But approximately, that is the amount of feet we'll cover. The reason is if you live on DeSoto, does anybody live on DeSoto, by the way? It's nice to see the representatives of DeSoto out here for us. So along the side of the ditch, the main ditch that we see, there's two of them that are open. And along the sides, there's a lot of grass. And when you're mowing or weed whacking, as the city public works does, it's difficult to get all that as perfectly as they want to, because some of that might go into the existing stormwater system. They catch a lot of it, but we want to remove that from the equation, because St. Augustine grass is a sink for nutrients. And every time that you cut it, there's a risk of letting those into the environment. So if we just get that out of the equation and replace it with rock, we can take that out of the equation entirely.
But I think you're also going to be removing a lot of pet droppings, because people tend to not clean up in the...
That's true.
They end up not doing it on somebody's yard, so I see it all the time.
So pet waste is a really good issue to talk about, too.
In somebody's yard, they clean it up in the median, they just are just like... Lifting.
But if it's in the median, no one sees it.
They think nobody's cleaning their kids' food, so that's...
Sure. Really. And the issues with pet waste are beyond the nutrients, but also the pathogens as well. So a lot of the things that wash down the stormwater system go into the lagoon. So that's an added benefit, you know, one of those things that I didn't account for that nicely happens alongside. So that brings us with water quality monitoring. We're not monitoring for everything. We did partner with FIT as part of this project. So Dr. Treffy said FIT has started taking some baseline samples. They're gonna continue to take samples and take some post samples. That way we can actually put some real science behind the project and determine, do these bioswales actually reduce nutrient inputs into the lagoon? So X number of feet, square feet of native plants reduce how much total nitrogen, phosphorus, suspended solids before they get into the lagoon? These are questions we have. So we do the science to figure that out. So the water quality monitoring is a vital part of that. And I got to thank FIT for being involved with that. That's fantastic. The educational videos, like the one we're recording today, they're going to be made available on the website so people can reference the material, make sure that I'm held accountable for the things that we want to do as part of the project. And It's a great way to get to the people that can't make it to these meetings in the evening. The items and the cards, these are something that we're working on right now. There's a really great company out of Brooklyn that does these educational cards. And we're creating a deck of actually 52 cards where they're going to be environmentally focused on certain topics where not only can they be educational, but they can be fun. And we'll give those away at events as incentives to people that answer questions about projects or really simple stuff, like we're going to have a wheel that you can spin at the next Ocean Reef Beach Festival, trying to get people involved in a fun way. 6 work days is the bare minimum. I imagine we're going to have a lot more than 6 work days to plant all these native plants. Someone has done a lot of native planting, and it does take more time than you think, but with many hands made for light work. So that's just the start. We have different Eagle Scout projects involved, like I said, so that'll take up some of that. Summer camps will take up some of those work days. And we're going to start with the workshops like this. So getting your feedback from it to see what, you know, what we can do best to educate and outreach. That's the main reason behind this, to educate about stormwater. And then to create online links so that we're always talking about the subject, people can reference it. We'll have an interactive map on the website with the project at the end of it, so you can click on it and hopefully see some of that nutrient data as clickable targets. And again, those targets of the water quality monitoring is to decrease the nutrient content of total suspended solids, nitrogen, phosphorus, and a few other things that run off that we might not account for. So any questions before we move on with the kind of the overall scope of the project?
I'm curious why you're removing grass and replacing it with rock.
Okay.
Grass absorbs water, and at least I don't like grass, but I know the problem associated, but it seems like grass would be better than rock.
This is great. You're right on target. I love it. So these are the signs that go up, and this will feed right into what you're saying right here. So according to UF, doing a little research, it's estimated that we can reduce the amount of nutrient input because grasses, right, your synoxy grasses are nutrients, right? They're just living nutrients. And as you cut them, those nutrients go somewhere. Typically, some of them might fall into the stormwater system. Some of them might get blown away or taken away. And this is for every resident. And this is why this project is really important as the first project of the soft infrastructure upgrades, because it starts the conversation. If we remove roughly 1,000 feet of regular lawn, sod, St. Augustine grass, you're removing that out of the system because it's going to be cut, right? And if you cut your lawn, that first top inch, and you don't take care of it, and it goes in stormwater, that's roughly 2 pounds of nitrogen for that 1,000 feet. Multiply that times all the homes in the satellite beach that get mowed, that don't have their grass clippings taken care of by a lawn company or by individuals. It's a lot of input into the system. And a lot of that ends up in our stormwater system. So by replacing with rock, we just remove it from the equation entirely, and that's a compounded benefit over time. Because over time, you're not going to be cutting it as much, you're not going to be losing as much of that grass in the system. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Excellent, good. I'm just going to pop back real quick. So these are the signs you're going to see. They're a little full of information. It's hard for me to slim things down sometimes. But basically the idea is we want to talk about the project itself, what it is, and who our partners are. In this case, the Natural Estuary Program and FIT, and I'm still trying to fit all the logos on there. We're going to talk about being a volunteer at the bottom and contact information for the city, because I think that's important on educational signage about a project. And then what are bioswales? So I'm just going to read you this real quick, because it's kind of hard to read from out there. But bioswales are one of the most commonly used stormwater practices. The idea behind it is that they are linear vegetated ditches which allow for the collection, conveyance, filtration, and infiltration of stormwater. They have many different titles and they can be referred to in many different ways. They're also referred to as grass swales, vegetated swales, filter strips, rain gardens, and a number of other nomenclatures to describe what bioswales are. But basically, it's about a 1/6 slope, so about 6 feet wide, 1 foot deep at the bottom, with a slope on either side that allow for stormwater to find a resting place where they can percolate through the soil and not immediately run off. Because with all of our hard surfaces, stormwater tends to run off down ditches and find its way to the lagoon faster than it would in a natural ecosystem where the rainwater would just percolate slowly through the soil, which is how all of our aquifers were created over the 3 million years that Florida has been Florida. Very similar sign is gonna go up. This sign is about native plants. So the bioswales is more focused on the strip of DeSoto and Median, where the native plants is focused more on the shoreline of the two ponds near the library. Why native plants? Because native plants are adapted to the environment. Their microecology has spent years learning how to behave with all the little critters that live in the soil, the biome that exists there, and their roots specifically are designed to live in this environment, which is very important. They require less water, no fertilizers, these types of things. So the survey that we took today was the pre-enhancement survey. I won't be taking it again at the end. This is a great way to figure out what you guys want to know. All this data collection, like we talked about with the water quality, that's more tools in our tool belt to be able to communicate at the end of the project how it went. If you want to go into the science of it, which is fun for me, we'll talk a little bit about it, but there's a lot of detail that Dr. Treffers is doing. And you can see it up here, all the different nitrogens, nitrates, nitrites, phosphorus, organophosphates. They're accounting for most all of it, and they're doing a really good job, even with the particulates of iron, aluminum, silicon, and carbon and calcium. I mean, they're really doing a good job with this water quality. So it's gonna be my job to monitor the survival rate of these plants, because if the plants don't survive, the project doesn't survive. So I'll be out there, you know, probably with a watering truck every occasional day, making sure that these plants are happy and healthy in case we don't get the right amount of rainwater that we want. I want to talk with Nicole Perna from Bear Island Center, who mentioned there's a nice additional moisture absorbent that you can add to a soil medium before you plant. So we're looking at some different options on how to make sure that our plants live, which is really important. So when I talk about the rainwater coming through the soil and why it's important that we have these areas, this picture is a little bit big scale when we talk about Florida's aquifer system, but I think it's important to look at the large scale of the environment to understand the small scale of our backyards. So it takes a long time for all this to happen, so we have to account for that. When rainwater falls and hits a hard surface, like I mentioned, it's just gonna run off. It's not gonna do its job of going into the soil and into the environment and slowly making its way down, in our case, down into the lagoon itself. We tend not to think about it that way, but you can see, like, next to the river there, the water table, where the water table is, all that water is gonna slowly go down into your grass in your yard, but it's also gonna make its way horizontally as well. If you can imagine two sponges side by side, dry. You take one, you run under your sink, and it's soaking wet. You put them next to each other. This is a fun experiment to do at home, too. It's a science experiment. You'll notice that the water will actually move sideways from one wet sponge to the dry sponge. Not just down, but also sideways. And then it'll make its way, in our case, to the lagoon. A lot of people that live in Brevard County, they forget that even if they live over by 95, they're still having an impact on the lagoon. So we here on the Barrier Island, we have a direct relationship with the lagoon. Even if we don't think about the water we use in our yard, or if our sprinklers are on and they're not facing our yard and they're hitting our driveway, or if our downspouts are pointing in the wrong direction. You know, that's why we try to influence people to think about rain barrels as an option to reduce the amount of water that comes in at one time. It's better to slow release a lot of our stormwater. And that's what these swales are gonna do. So we talked about the work days and the plantings and these different bioswales, a little bit about how you can be involved. But mostly, it's in my mind, it's about the kids. So these work days, as much as I invite the adults to be there, if you know anybody that has kids in the school system, get them involved, because when we have youth involved, we're teaching lessons that'll carry on beyond ourselves. And that's kind of a big part of this. It's not really written in the proposal that way, but when I talked about it with the NEP, that was one of the things that they liked. The idea was engaging not just residents, but also all the citizens of the city. Yeah?
Will you all make a plan for your work days? Are you gonna make a flyer for it?
It'll be just like the website. We'll have information, the Facebook page, and we'll put up some flyers at the schools, and we'll make it available to anybody that wants
to. Okay, so you guys are gonna put flyers at each of the schools so that they can put them out to the teachers and to the students so everyone's aware.
Absolutely, okay. And at the end of it, you'll see the flyer that we have that's currently at FIT, and I'm gonna go to Eastern Florida next week and talk to them about that. They're gonna have a kind of career work fair day thing that all of the students are gonna be involved in.
Okay.
So here's a kind of image, a little bit of the two different types that we talked about. Forgive my simple PC paintbrush version of how to create art. I'm more of a scientist than an artist, but if you can use your imagination, the black here, that's the current ditch area along the sort of those two main long ditch areas, right? And a little bit of water that is resting in there that makes its way to the west and then down into the stormwater ponds by the library, eventually out into the lagoon. Currently, it's all grass. So if we put the rocks here on the side, like I said, we eliminate that edging that happens where there's a lot of, you know, missed grass clippings. And then we plant native plants like spartinas, dune sunflowers, and other vegetation that I'll talk about here in a second. And that swale here is kind of like this swale there. And again, 1/6 slope, so 1 foot deep, 6 feet wide. Variety of native plants. There is currently a swale in there to some degree, but that's an old infrastructure. And it was planted a long time ago, and a lot of that is filled in, and the grass has grown in. So some of this is just going back over things that already exist and making them better. Some of those plants that we're going to use are on this list here. If anybody is a green thumb or a master gardener, you'll recognize a few of these. And this all falls in line with other things we're doing in the city. The next workshop is called Nice and Native because it's talking about our Beautification Board's initiative to move towards a more native criteria for our yard of the month. So projects like this help pave the way, pardon the reverse pun, to the future of what these types of projects are going to be for not only us, but also for the community. So dune sunflower, kumthis, railroad vines, spotted bee balm, blanket flowers, salt grasses, probably not sea oats, they snuck their way in there. Different cord grasses, spartinas like I talked about, butterfly milkweed, beach morning glories, sea oxide daisies specifically, some beech elder, maybe even some ferns in some areas. And the idea is that some of these plants like it wetter, some of them like it drier. So we'll plant the plants that like it wettest at the bottom and the middle, and the drier ones on the side. Leaving room for them to grow was a lesson that I learned, that we learned as part of the project that the city did out front. If you look at City Hall, you'll notice that the four areas in front of the pond there are all vegetated with native plants. Well, when we planted them really, really dense. And they kind of overgrew each other a little bit. So this time we'll spread things out a little bit, and then we can always come back later and replant in any gaps that we may have missed. So this is the community outreach part of it. Thank you for doing this. Has anybody thought about it? Do you think it'd be a good idea if we did some of these workshops at other locations, restaurants? Is that something, show of hands, anybody think that's a good idea? Yeah. Anybody think that they should just hold them here? Is this good enough? Yeah? All right, so 50-50 mix, a little bit of each.
I think something like the Reef Festival that was at Pelican Beach would be good to hold one.
Okay.
You might get a lot of people who don't necessarily know that they're happening,
right,
stumble upon it.
So we will definitely be there.
Maybe give the presentation a couple times throughout the day.
And we could do a couple of different ones depending on what time of day it is. Okay, that's a great idea. Thanks. So, like I said, all this is going to be online. And I want to remind everyone that the work that you're doing in these surveys is really going to help out. And feel free to go on afterwards at the end of the year and fill it out again on the website. Because we want to remain green, so less paperwork, the better. So we put all this online as well. So like I mentioned, our project partners were FIT, National Estuary Program, even DEP as well. DEP has been very helpful with getting the educational aspect, a lot of the stormwater information out. We're working with them as well as FIT Sustainability Board and Balance for Earth, who does all of our video and educational video outreach, which is really great to get all that information on Facebook and YouTube and the like. So, just as a show of hands, does anybody here think they'll want to come out and join us for a planting day? All right, yeah, 100%. That's perfect people to show up. That's great.
Do you want me to water it for you too while I'm out there?
Well, if you use a rain barrel, that's okay.
Actually, I was ready to start digging tonight.
That will happen. So we'll try to really publicize those work days. I've been going around door to door and knocking on people's doors. You may have, you know, had me knock on your door. And the idea was that those people that live on DeSoto, particularly, you know, you folks, this is in your backyard, even everyone that lives in that watershed, I mean, I live down the street, these are the people that we really want to make aware of the project, so when it happens, they're comfortable with it happening.
I'm sorry about yelling at you, you can't see it off my lawn too, I didn't see when I saw it.
Well, I dressed as nice as I could, you know, I really wanted to, to have a name tag on there. So this is the flyer we're going to have, as we had the question about what's it going to look like. So we got some native plants there. It's a little more beachy, but the main idea is there. We want to teach people about native plants, native planting, leadership skills, and sustainable design, and how to work as a team. So before each of these work days, everyone's going to be invited to just kind of sit under a nice little, one of those, you know, Walmart tents that we have in there and talk about safety and minding your surroundings and helping out your friends. And if you're tired, take a break, make sure you drink plenty of water, these types of things, because you get excited and you get involved with stuff and sometimes you forget to take care of yourself as much as you need to. So we'll have plenty of refreshments out there for all the volunteers as well. And anybody that needs volunteer hours, this is a great way for them to get it. So, again, my name is Nick Sanzone. I'm the Environmental Programs Coordinator for the City of Satellite Beach. I appreciate y'all coming out tonight. The next workshop is going to be nice and native, and it's going to be focused on native plants in the community, how bioswales are functional for your homes, and how they'll actually help facilitate you to more likely be chosen for a Yard of the Month. As you've seen recently, a lot of the Yard of the Months have somewhat of a sustainable theme to them, and hopefully we'll see more of that in the future, because not only is it aesthetically pleasing, it's functional as well. And that's the kind of lesson that we're trying to learn and teach as we go through this process of instituting bioswales in the city infrastructure and then in the future for residents. The next program that you're gonna see, it's on your list there, it's Shorelines. It was a talk we're gonna have later in the year. And the idea behind that is the city is willing to put forward a small grant program. We'll talk more about that in the near future. $500 for residents that live along the lagoon, specifically those residents along the lagoon for this pilot study, can put themselves into a project program where they'll get vetted and chosen to create a bioswale along their backyard. Because these are the people who have direct impact on the lagoon, more so than the folks of us that live interior, but we all have an impact. So if anybody wants to put a bioswale in their home, we'll look at more programs in the future about how to help do that. Right now, we're just going to try to lead by example and show you how it's done by doing this DeSoto project. First thing that we did, which I recommend everybody do if you're going to do anything in your yard, whether it's plant a tree or run a line, is call before you dig. It's free. And if you call before you dig, they'll come out and they'll mark all your lines for you so that you don't run into anything. If you're planting a tree in your yard, call before you dig because the roots of that tree will grow. It's really nice to plant a tree, and it's even better to plant a tree that, you know, doesn't ruin your plumbing as well. I'll also think about solar and the future of your home if you want to use the PACE program to use solar. The PACE program is something that we have in the city that allows residents to get discounts on solar as well as other green infrastructure in their home. If you do that, great. But if you plant a tree and it overshadows your roof, it's a lot harder to use your solar. So all these things we have to think of at the same time. So when we do these workshops, we're always going to be going back to some of these other topics and just kind of going back and forth. I'll take some questions from the audience if you guys have any questions about this project or the projects.
So you haven't talked about long-term maintenance of the bioswale.
Okay, great. So long-term maintenance of the bioswale. Public Works currently maintenance that area. The idea is that this will be less maintenance for them than mowing grass because they'll let everything grow and they'll cut it back maybe three times a year in the season, instead of mowing constantly. So there will be some maintenance, absolutely. And I'll go out there, I mean, I live down the street, so I'll go out there, and if I see it getting to a point where, you know, the next 2-3 weeks, I'll put it on the docket and let Public Works know, hey, you know, we're gonna wanna go out there and trim the dune sunflower back because the dune sunflower is getting wild. Maybe the railroad vine has made its way into the street or something like that. But we'll have a regular grass buffer around most of these bioswales so that they don't edge up against the road completely, they just focus more on the interior. So they'll be able to take a mower around the outside, any of those grass clippings will fall into the bioswale, turn into actual nutrients from the plants, and not make their way into the stormwater system.
Given that DeSoto is one way in each direction, and relatively narrow, what is the projected impact on travel, sort of during these, this construction period? Have you guys thought about that?
So the, I think what we're gonna probably do is have people park at the library and walk maybe, and we'll have everything set up for them, just so that there's not a lot of people, or maybe park at the Soto Park itself, where the manatees hang out at, and then walk down on the sidewalks, just to reduce any car traffic on the side of the street. Because if we do meet the volunteer turnout that we want, we don't want any traffic. And I'll be out there with the orange vest making sure that the kids are combed off and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's like, you know, the first part of the trip.
Absolutely. And we might need someone to tell people to keep moving too, because, you know, if you're seeing this going on, it might slow down traffic as well. But that's a good point to make. So yeah, we want to keep people kind of carpooling or riding bikes, keeping it as green as possible.
That's a good focus on our green community.
Yeah, I mean, that's what we did for our community garden. That was the first green achievement target. We got a lot of people riding bikes to that, which was great.
Is there any study done on when there's an extreme rainfall event, will this improve or not have an improvement on flooding on Soto?
Great question. So, yes. We looked at the total volume of the bioswales themselves and then how much rainwater would occur annually and on the typical rainfall, not talking about hurricanes, which is like regular rainfall events. It will help hurricanes, but it'll really help little rainfall events. Okay. So, I have it in the actual report. It's around 29,000 gallons of water.
There won't be a negative impact, though.
No, no, no. You're actually increasing the total volume of where water can go. And it'll sit in that swale and then percolate down.
Okay. Any excess would still go into the runoff?
It would go into the existing infrastructure. So that's why we built it in combination with the existing infrastructure, as opposed to building something brand new. Might as well make what works work a little better.
Last question, probably doesn't, is completely out of the purview, but I think you might be able to use some of this as a little bit of latitude to fix the issue. Just on the other side of Rosada, there's a Pokemon thing, crystal, in the middle of the swale.
Really?
So yeah, and we'll see constantly, there'll be like cars pulled over to the side and this crowd of people. And I was like, yeah, what's going on? Is there some kind of fire or something? It's like, and I actually stopped and asked, and all these adults are out there parking all over the swale,
flipping their
and like walking out of the street and stuff. I almost went to kill them. I ran into that one the other day, trying to make a U-turn or something.
Still,
they're still out there. And there's
really?
Adults like Pokemon. Yeah, it's just right at the corner on that side of the zone.
Hmm.
And you may be able to use your influence to say, listen, I don't need these cars parking the swale anymore. We need to have that Pokemon crystal.
Okay. That's nice. I guess I could reach out to the Pokey people.
Whatever you gotta do.
I don't know.
Put your left foot in.
I have some ideas about outreach in order for you to get more press marketing.
Please.
FIT has the morning radio, and they allow free advertisements or announcements for community service.
Please tune in next week. I'll be on the Coastal Update with FIT.
Right.
So that's Terry Wright. And she's fantastic. She's invited us to come on and talk a little bit about this as well as some of our other sustainability initiatives. So yes, please, everybody out there, you folks here, next week, I believe it's going to be the 31st in the afternoon. It might air the next day. We'll put a blast on Facebook and stuff like that as well.
Get Florida Today active. Let them write an article to get these pamphlets in big tackle shops, pet stores, hardware stores, even the high school announcements. I don't know if they still do announcements in high school. They still do announcements on speakers in schools? Oh. Well, they do.
I think they do.
Okay.
We're also starting the Junior Sustainability Program at the Laura. This will coincide with that as well.
Environmental clubs in schools. I don't know if they exist.
Satellite has one.
Okay.
Satellite has one. It's really good.
You can get the word out to them.
I'm going to Satellite next week, I believe. No, you're riding the ball. Yeah, these are just some of the things that we're going to be doing. And I like the big and tackle shops, the pet stores.
Yeah.
I don't know about Publix, maybe.
Yeah,
Ace Hardware is really nice. Ace Hardware works with us a lot. We can probably reach out to them, maybe some of the nurseries, realtors, exactly, that are in the area, those types of folks that really care about the environment, that want to be involved. Anything?
Any plans to identify the plants that you plan just to educate people?
Absolutely. That's very important. Thank you for reminding me. Skipped over a few things. Little signages will be installed, but we'll also have a virtual walkthrough of the swale available online at the city website. with balance for ourself, we can do some drone footage.
So I've got one angle on here right now.
Okay. Well, what we'll do is we'll load up this next slide. We'll show you a video of the area in a little more detail. We'll talk about that.
It'd be really cool while you're doing your video presentation to show the before pictures.
Absolutely.
You know, and then what you envision it to look like. And also a map of the site, and maybe include water flow or, that sort of stuff.
Okay. So,
just for orientation, for people that don't live here.
That's a good point.
So what we'll show now is a quick overview video, before video, because you're right, I think...
That's just one angle, and it's like half of the setup. I'm just flying over in the street view.
It's a no-fly zone, man.
So is the idea to do the entire...
just the entire thing at different angles of it as well. So
this area here, this is what we're talking about when we're talking about the open ditch. Where the rocks go on the sides. Where there is some room, there'll be some like mini swales in these areas, not as much as in the totally open areas that are a little bit more towards the west. So like I was saying, we'll leave a little room where they can come through with the mower, but this area here is where we want to focus on reducing a lot of that immediate stormwater impact. Because again, that's the low end of the slope before all the water runs off. So if we can put a little bit of swell there, we can help it percolate a little bit slower. And as much as we talk about nutrient reduction, with stormwater, one of the biggest impacts is the immediate rush of all that fresh water into the ecosystem. It's something that we don't tend to think about, but with all the urbanization of rooftops, roadways, and other hard infrastructure.
That guy's gonna stop and check that poop.
Well, that hard infrastructure, when I was in school, the one thing that really hit me was a very simple graph that just showed the spike that happens when you have a storm event, as opposed to in a natural ecosystem where it slowly percolates through the system. That freshwater spike is something that the environment hasn't really adapted to over its millions of years of evolving to live in a very simple ecosystem, since human beings have kind of altered the landscape in this environment in the last 100 years, 200 years or so, especially in the last 50, 60 years, we see that hard infrastructure really having impacts on the fresh water that's coming into the ecosystem, especially the lagoon ecosystem, that typically has had a slower percolation of fresh water into the ecosystem.
So you have a lot of trees.
Yes.
Are you keeping the trees?
Keeping all trees. We wouldn't want to remove anything unless it got knocked out in a hurricane and was a danger to
so
people.
Even though they're non-native trees or?
Most of them are. A lot of green buttonwoods. Okay. If you see any non-natives, let me know.
Okay.
Carrot wood is the next invasive species, and what we're going to talk about in another workshop, but we'll touch on that briefly. Another initiative is to remove carrot wood from the city. We did Brazilian pepper. We did Malaleuca. We did Australian pine. And some of them still pop up because those seeds from those plants are very resilient. I think the life of a Brazilian pepper is almost 100 years. Even if you grind it into the ground, it still is pretty resilient. Just a testament to its DNA. But carrot wood is next, because the carrot wood is something that we see growing up under power lines because of the birds, and the birds releasing it naturally in certain areas. And if we can create a program to remove and replace, that's our plan. And you'll see that coming through soon. We're going to start growing native plants. If anybody wants to be part of a native plant nursery program in the near future to start nursing some of these little plants, and then we'll take them and then bring them into people's homes by replacing the carrot wood with a green buttonwood, a gumbo limbo, something like that, maybe some of these palms.
That's very perfect.
Titusville does a good job of giving trees away, so we wanted to kind of follow the good example of our cities. And on that thread, one of the last things that I want to mention to everyone tonight is that we will be having the Sustainability Summit, February 8th, right across the way here at Sally Beach City Hall in the Civic Center. We're going to have all the different sustainability boards and environmental boards from other cities that exist in Brevard County and a few other partners, as well as the zoo. And Chris Castro from Orlando is going to come in and talk to us about the sustainability programs that Orlando has, So you guys coming out tonight make me think that you'd be perfect candidates to join us at that workshop on the 8th, just to kind of see what's going on from a sustainability standpoint, because a lot of these projects are, without doubt, sustainable in design. I'm just going to play that one more time in the background, just because it's kind of nice to watch.
What's the time for that?
The February 8th.
It starts at 5. And we're going to have a quick workshop by Dr. Ken Lindemann and Zachary Eichels from MIT, talking about how to create the plan that creates the board. So that whole process of doing a resiliency study in the city, figuring out what you need to do for the infrastructure and how to manage not only your sustainability economically, but your sustainability with infrastructure and projects and programs as well. So like putting solar on City Hall is one of the first things that we did, because it was a nice piece of low hanging fruit that was highly visible with big returns, but two, it was really important to generate that income, because it's going to, in the long run, make us money, so it's saving us money. So we recommend that that's some of those things that happen. And over the course of that workshop on the 8th at 5, we'll start, and then 6, we'll get a little brief introduction from each of the different boards, and then we'll have some speakers. But again, the main idea behind it is to tell everybody what we're up to, share ideas, and create a network of these boards. And if you want to be on one of these boards at the city, always taking applications. Currently we're full. We have a really great turnout for our sustainability board. We have a wonderful group of people that are fantastic to work with, but we need more people in the audience talking to us. So for all the people out there, for all you folks here, we invite you to come to the third Wednesday of every month. The sustainability board meetings right here at City Hall. It's an easy way to be involved and talk about projects and talk about any of these issues. So did I kind of talk about biosolids enough? You think we talk about that topic? If I was to ask you how wide they would be typically, everybody knows how wide they'd be?
6 feet.
6 feet.
I question your 6 to 1, because you said 1 foot deep. But if they're only 6 feet wide and they're 1 foot deep, that's more like a 3 to 1.
Is that diagram that's wrong?
6 foot wide and 1 foot deep, that's a 3 to 1.
If it was 2 feet deep.
If it was 2 feet deep, that'd be.
And then we fill that foot with soil.
It actually have to be wider. I think it would have to be 12 feet wide and 1 foot deep. And this would be 6 foot. But
you're right. It's 6 foot deep. But it'll end up looking like it's 1 foot, but it's really 2.
Oh, okay.
Because we're digging it down to put the soil there and the plants, right. And then they'll have that soil. Thank you. I need to make that clear.
It's bureaucracy.
Well, it's me being 6 steps ahead at the end of the project, going back and talking about it, that I need to hit those fine details.
Oh, yeah.
So yeah, when you do this well, the idea is that there'll be a little bit of a weed barrier on the bottom, and then some soil, and then the native plants. That way, when it hits that, it'll pond a little bit and then percolate through. Yet, preventing any of that excess weed growth like torpedo grass and wadelia and things like that.
So is the swale 6 feet wide that we're looking at there?
Is the ditch.
Like the green strip.
The green strip is, I think it's like 12 or 15 in some places. It's beautiful.
The swale itself is about 6 feet wide, but you've got about 10 feet
on each side.
Almost 10 feet from the street to the middle of the swale. The whole thing might be 20 feet wide.
Yeah. And it varies. And it varies in different places, because the road will have an extra turn lane going east at one point, and then it has an extra dip coming west. So it changes a little bit, but that's why we want to focus on the median main portion of those areas. And again, the rocks will go in the ditch, and the bioswales themselves without rocks will go in the main medians, and then the native plants will go all throughout it, but more specifically mangroves and spartina along the ponds, which additional partner, I forgot to mention, Marine Discovery Center will be helping us along with UCF to acquire some of these plants as well. So partnerships are huge. We're going to keep doing projects like this in the future. We have a number of grants out there that we're writing and trying to get. So if you want to see more projects like this, just hit us up on Facebook and say that you like it. Come out and join us for the events. Look for those flyers. If you need any of those flyers and you want them, feel free to email me directly, and I can provide them for you via email in PDF format. And if you don't like the design on it, we can special design a little bit if you want to take some time with me, make it more to your liking. Again, I want to thank everybody for coming out. This is our first workshop in the series, the 2018 Sustainability Workshops. feel free to call City Hall, 773-4409, extension 227, and contact me, Nick Sanzo. Thank you guys so much.
Do I need a workshop punch card or something and a t-shirt?